Welcome back, everyone, after like a, what, 4 or 6 week hiatus? It's been a little while. Okay. Labor Day threw us off a bit, but we're not gonna let that happen again. Sorry about that. All right, public comment time. Hello, Susan.
Hello. I'm your public today.
If you want to, but you're welcome to.
Well, Rob, have you passed this report around?
No, actually, Marilyn's gonna take that up.
Okay, so Marilyn has a report from us that she's gonna report on.
I see.
Or if this would be a good time?
This would not be a good time.
No, okay, yeah, all right.
Yeah, I mean, it's just we can't, if we want, we can start adding this to the agenda.
Yeah.
Do you think it'll become regular meetings?
I hope to.
Okay.
But I think that, I'm sorry, you hope to, you're willing to stay through the meeting, you're interested in staying through the meeting.
Yeah, what I'm just saying is from now on, if I know that that is something we should block time out for.
I'll send you an email.
Okay, I mean, you're welcome to take two to three minutes to give us a report, but if we want to have like an interactive conversation, I'm happy to put it on the agenda in future.
Okay, that's fine. Well, we've been meeting every other week, and we've looked seriously at what it's going to take to start a 501c3, and that's going to take us a little while, but we're certainly collecting the information and getting going on that. Have had a lot of activity on the Facebook page, and once I learned Twitter, I suppose we'll get going on that. And the pages are linked to the Tree Northampton website, which is it's a software. It's on drawing the blank. Well, whatever. And, you know, we have a really wonderful member who's really good at connecting things, and we did have one public tabling event. At River Valley Market about 3 weeks ago, and that went well. And Rob thinks we've got about 15, 16 requests for trees from our efforts, so he's happy. So that's about it. We do a little bit every week.
Great. Thank you. All right, approval of previous minutes. Did we get?
No.
Okay.
I'm sorry. Totally my fault.
Okay. So we're not approving previous minutes?
No. You have a copy, right?
Yes.
Oh, we are. Okay.
Yeah.
Oh, you didn't get an email.
Oh, okay. That's fine. All right.
I apologize. Should we take time to read them?
She needs glasses.
Yeah, that's what we're going to need to do. I do not need to read them.
I read them.
Oh, okay.
I should have read some.
Any corrections to the minutes?
Just a few typos, but I can email those to you.
Yeah.
Yep.
If they're not substantive, then
no.
All right. I need a motion.
Motion.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Minutes have been approved as they stand, barring minor grammatical corrections. Okay.
Can you say something about the last minutes?
Yeah.
That I already discussed with you. So, because I know, Marilyn, you've been going on the website and checking out the minutes, all of which should be up there.
Oh, they are now? Okay.
They should be now. There was an issue with the new city website, so it was locked out, and some minutes have disappeared, so I was able to add them. But the last set of minutes, there was discussion on when the prior meeting ended, if we were going to extend it and so forth, if you remember that.
Yeah.
And so you wanted me to amend those minutes, but technically, you shouldn't be able to vote on extending a meeting if you earmarked time 4 to 6, if you leave it 4 open. So technically, that vote really didn't matter to extend the meeting.
Okay.
You can't extend the meeting?
Not if you say 4 to 6 or 3 to 5.
Okay.
So you should leave it.
So that's just for us to know in the future, that we cannot, if per Robert's rules.
Yep.
If we post a meeting for a particular period from such and such to such and such, we cannot extend beyond that period. I still think that the minutes should reflect what happened at the meeting. And so that did happen at the meeting, and so we should just, I feel like we should, the minutes should reflect exactly what happened. We voted it down, so it's kind of immaterial. We didn't go over.
Okay.
But let's just remember that in the future. That it's just a reminder that I need to hear from you if there's topics that are important, we need to put them on the agenda so that we stay on topic.
Right.
Anything further about minutes? All right, chair reports. I'm forgetting what I have in my chair before. Todd, I'm gonna give you time later on in the agenda to talk about your presence at yesterday's subcommittee meeting, right?
Okay.
So I won't mention that. And you are still, Is it in your
yes.
camp right now with the mayor?
Yes.
Okay.
It's my camp, the mayor's office.
So remember, we were going to ask the mayor for his support in our bringing together a conversation with the various departments about making sure that trees are central to certain conversations as they happen, permitting, especially during the permitting process, in light of two unfortunate situations where trees were taken down when they shouldn't have been. So that is still in process. I sent something to the, or no, I, yes, I drafted something and sent it to the mayor with Todd and Rich's approval. And the mayor has kind of asked for Rich's further input, and that's where it stands.
Yeah, the mayor's office is looking for clarification as to what the meeting was about. And I guess for logistics, does the mayor have to be there? Is it just going to be an internal meeting amongst the department heads, folks in our fall, so
mm-hmm.
So I apologize. It got sent to me when I was, and I've just been kind of overwhelmed, but I will get to it.
Okay. All right. Do we need to give you a deadline on that? Or would that be helpful?
The deadline's October, actually, according to the last set of minutes, I think. It was not.
All right.
I'll get it done.
Okay.
Sure, right. You can give me a deadline if you want. I always work well on a person.
All right. October 1st.
Okay. They're done.
I'm trying to think if there's anything other chair report. Oh, Rich and I created a flag for all the tree watering bags that is going to be very visible and attached to all the bags, basically saying emergency water me. We worked together on the language, and my design person created it. And then when we when it's in, they're going to be plastic and attachable by zip ties, which means we can take them off in times of non-drought and put them back on in times of drought. So it's really just a way of trying to galvanize more people to help out with the watering. I kind of discussed this plan with, I had a nice long conversation with Worcester, Ruth Stewart of the Worcester Tree Initiative. And so she said that flagging water bags is helpful, and getting more volunteers to help out with this is really critical in a time of dire watering needs. So working on that. Had other interesting conversations with Ruth, but I'll save that for other parts of the agenda. I think that's it on my end.
Okay.
And we'll turn to you.
So I have a couple of items. The tree inventory, so last time we met, we got an award at the... So the tree inventory has been awarded to Davy Tree. They are the, they actually were the middle bidder. The low bidder was Arbor Pro, but they submitted, unfortunately, an incomplete bid. So their bid got tossed out, so Davy Tree's bid was, you know, awarded bid. So they, total bid amount... $74,650. And there's...
How old is it?
$74,650. And there, we're actually, we had enough money so we could do the alternates. So they are going to do the inventory of 11,200 public shade trees. They're going to identify 2,000 planting sites. They're also going to inventory all the trees in the public parks and city cemeteries. And provide a tree, they're going to deliver actually all this information in Treekeeper, which is their software that they have, for us to use as a 3-month demo. But we're also going to have it delivered in Esri or Shapefile or GeoDatabase and an Accents database as well. They're also going to provide us with a copy or provide us with a multi-year management plan. So I think we're actually doing all right in this aspect. I'm kind of excited, actually. I'm really excited to get this thing off the ground. So I brought the contracts down to the auditor before this meeting, so they'll be signed, I hope, tomorrow or the next day. So there could be potentially a kickoff meeting with Andy Hillman and the folks from Davy, possibly the first week of October. So their timelines, the delivery date for the actual, all the inventory information is going to be November, the end of November.
Wow.
Yep. They flood the date. They're just like ants.
How many planting sites, Rich?
2,000.
Oh, 2,000.
The electronic management or the multi-year management plan is going to be delivered at the end of December. And then they're going to give us, like I said, 3-month trial of Treekeeper, which will actually give us the, it'll be nice, I've never used it, so I played around with the demo they had online. But as you know, I think I've talked about before, that we're actually moving to a new platform, which is Municity. I'm not sure what the interface is between Treekeeper and Municity, and if Municity can duplicate what we're, Treekeeper can do. I personally don't think it can, but I'm not an expert. So when we have this demo, I'm gonna sit with a few folks from the IT department and Andy Heather as well from our department to kind of go through this and see if, because Treekeeper does everything. It does everything from work order, from asset management for trees, to work orders, to, I believe, tree risk assessments. So it's pretty, have you ever used it, Jay?
No, but Davey worked on the AOB program, and I've seen them yeah, using it. It's very efficient.
It is efficient, and I think it's based on, it's really has a lot of features that iTree has. Mm-hmm. So the online one that I was messing around with, you can do a tree benefit calculator, which I'll find it to be very handy, because it's really, to have that information and send it to a resident and say, look, this tree that you have, you're going to cut down, is about to, you're about to lose this. Mm-hmm. And this is what this tree has done for you so far, or for the city so far, even though it's not a public shade tree. So it's going to be really, I'm excited. I'm very excited. It's been a long time coming. So that's that item.
Todd, just a follow-up question.
Yes, sir. I'm sorry.
Did I miss the huge press release on this?
We haven't had a press release yet. We're going to have a press release. So we have
weeks.
We haven't. No, I don't do that. So that's the only day I do that. I'll get any information. I think we're going to wait until I can have the actual kickoff meeting. When the actual kickoff meeting will begin, that's when the press release will be probably based around, I would think. So I've got to figure out how the City Hall wants to handle that. I don't really think it's usually kickoff meeting is just really you have maybe myself or the city engineer, probably the director. If you have a regular contract like Plaskin Park, they have to give out the meeting with all the contractors involved and everything.
So in the data that's submitted to us and in that format, is it going to be possible to look at the sidewalk data that's being generated from this sidewalk survey that DPW was doing and look at kind of how the street trees relate to sidewalks, whether they be in the way of future planned sidewalks or, you know, where there's missing shade for pedestrians?
I would think so, especially when it's, you know, in an ESRI form, because it can be actually brought into our GIS system. So one of the, you know, if we don't, and so municity basically is based off of GIS. That's the work order system that we're going to have. So GIS is the driver for everything that we have. We're very fortunate we have a very, very good, strong GIS person in our office presently. So the goal is to take all this information that's gathered and create GIS layers that will be available to the public. Similar to, you can look at different public maps that we have through GIS through the city. So you'd be able to access those things, so anybody could, anyone could look at it. So that's the goal, would be to do that. Now, if we decide to use Treekeeper, that and not GIS is the main software product to actually drive the tree inventory and keep a running record of everything, and that, I don't know what the access would be for that. But GIS is you can make your read-only very easily. I mean, Rob actually has access to it for the actual pre-planning locations. But anyone can actually look at it because it is on the city's portal.
Todd brings up the issue of future sidewalks, which I'm not really, I'm aware of where sidewalks might be, but not of any plans for future sidewalks.
More on that later, excuse me.
You have?
Yeah, I'll talk about that during the walk-bike thing.
Great.
So that's, Rob and I took a little ride yesterday to Amherst Nursery to go look at our tree stock that's over there, which I thought actually looked to be in pretty good health considering, actually very good health considering how dry it was. So we met with John, and I don't know, Rob, did you follow up today? We were able to go back and tag some trees.
I tagged everything on that site except for American hornbeams.
Okay.
There were a lot of American hornbeams that were going to tag 30 of them, which is plentiful.
Okay.
So I have a list of them. Okay. Tag trees. There's another site where we're still missing. So we've tagged about 100 of the 180 trees.
Okay.
And then we have to go to Hadley to tag the other 80.
So we talked. Obviously, we've talked about this in the past, and I think it's on the agenda, so I'm done.
Yes, all tree planting.
Right, so I'm not going right. to, just going to let you know that we did that yesterday, and we'll talk more about it in that time frame.
Right.
I do want to let you know that here's a site plan approval from the DPW that was sent to us from planning, and I do want to give you some good news. The good news is I got to review it before anything happened.
That's great.
So
that's huge.
Actually, there's been two different Brown Hill Road, they actually have Brown Hill Road project, which there are some trees there that have to come down that were even going to be preserved, and they've asked me to go with them. So that's also positive that the message is getting through. And this Hinckley Street project, which is a condominium project at 121 Hinckley Street, there is one large, massive sugar maple there that was struck by lightning many years ago that is completely rotten on the inside and needs to be removed before it falls on someone or something. So the communication level has been very good. Actually, sometimes the quote too, but there's a lot of too much communication. But it's nothing I can do about it. I gotta take it while I can get it. And the last thing I want to talk about is we are still watering trees once a week. So we're still going to keep going until leaves drop, because we'll have to see. Hopefully we'll get some more rain in October. It is going to get cooler, but it's been a long summer. And we're also seeing a lot of mature trees die. So we are really kind of scrambling operationally to keep the trees watered, to address trees that are dead now, which Village, there's a few on Main Street, there's some on the South Florence, and deal with trying to figure out how we're going to actually work on the planting, so that'll be a conversation we're going to talk about going forward, to how many trees we're going to plant, so on and so forth, before winter. And then the tree inventory, which, you know, there won't be, the full-time staff, we won't be doing that much of the interaction with the TV tree. And one of the things that we have, folks, this was an interesting, just to kind of give you kind of what I deal with on a daily basis, and I'll just stop my time. But, so I was driving around Olander Drive, just to go actually look at the mature trees that they're removing in regards to the Village Hill development. So I came across this this oak tree in front of this home right here, and I drove by it really slowly, and I was looking at it, and it looked really strange to me, because I'm like, you know, the root ball's completely exposed. I'm interested in what's going on here. So I just drove by it. Honestly, I drove right by it, and then I slammed on the brakes in the middle of the street. And I put it in reverse and backed up.
In a safe manner.
In a very safe manner, in the middle of the road, and got out of the vehicle. And I came to realize that...
Show your hands up.
I didn't hide. Now, I put my vest on, though, so I was all safe. So the folks that live here decided that they wanted to dig this tree up and move it.
Wow, it was a public tree.
How big a tree is that? I can't tell from
that. It's a columnar oak tree, so it's probably, I don't know, maybe 4 inches.
4 inches?
4 inches or so. So I ended up, there were two people standing in this yard in the back digging another hole. So I said, hey, you know, I'm the tree ward, how are you? And so, hey, how are you? And so what are you guys doing here? Oh, we're moving that tree. I'm like, oh, you are? Yeah. I said, you can't do that. So long and short of it is that here's an example of folks who are well-intended, because they actually want to replace this tree with two other elms, to replace the elm that was lost there, Dutch elm disease, and has died. So they have asked to remove this tree and plant it somewhere else the proper way through a public shade tree area. But I guess my whole point to this is that how important education is. And I think based on the emails that I have gotten from people, based upon the work that Rob has done with, and anyone else has done with door hangers, the work that Tree Northampton has done, because there have been people just not hounding me, but constant emails about, you know, hey, I hear we can get free shade trees, you know, how can I do this, you know? So that educational piece, I think, is actually working. This educational piece needs a little work. And I'm not quite sure how to reach out to folks about this kind of thing. Definitely folks are well-intended. They actually want to replace the trees that were there originally, but, you know, just moving the tree and not talking to anybody is obviously not, you know, not really right. So
sounds. I mean, without taking up too much of your time, I think this is an important topic. I think that we've talked about putting an educational insert into the, for example, water bill or whatever it is that goes out to every resident or every property owner. Say, and it could just be, hey, you have a tree warden. Here's the role of the tree warden. If you have any concern about a tree that, a public tree or what you might think might be a public tree, contact the tree warden. And then we can also just give a little blurb of Mass General Law. So we've been kind of batting around this idea of getting an educational piece out for a while. It's a good winter project.
Yep.
So, you know, maybe we can find a volunteer. I'd be happy to help work on that language.
And I think a good place to start might be to go in front of the city council and just give them an update on what the commission has been doing, and even update on the structure of, you know, the warden and the commission, and the difference of, you know, what it was in the past. I think, you know, there's...
That's
interesting.
I thought it would be good, and I think we may have touched on this a while back, but actually doing an annual report. You know, it doesn't have to be extravagant, but an annual report, which would coincide with giving a presentation. So actually the counselors have something to read and say that, you know, this is the accomplishments of the Public Shade Tree Commission.
You volunteering to put that together?
No, I'm not volunteering. I'm just putting that out there. I've got enough to put together.
Actually, I'd be happy to craft something. Because one reason I've been going through all the minutes on the website is just I've been putting together like a one-pager of everything we've accomplished so far. So I could turn that into just like a one or two pager, if that would be beneficial.
Yeah.
I've already started it, so.
Yeah, I mean, I think if you draft that, I would definitely love to work with you on polishing it. And then, and your thoughts of going in front of city council is because it's the city council, or we're on TV, or what are your thoughts there?
Well, twofold. One, I think the city council could possibly benefit from a reminder of the current structure, and that it's not the structure that it was 2 years ago. And two, I think it's a good platform to kind of begin, you know, a more public discussion on some of the more nuanced elements of the public education that may need to take place.
Mm-hmm. So would it be a matter of getting on their agenda? Because it's not something that would be easily done in 3 minutes.
No, I think, yeah, getting on their agenda and having a, you know, 15-minute, you know, time slot to give a short presentation, answer some questions. And with, you know, armed with a quote-unquote annual report or whatever would be pretty good. And everyone's putting together their FY16 annual reports, you know, starting now-ish anyways.
Okay. Well, I would love to do that after the national elections, because I am flat out. But between November and December, I'd be happy to, and what I can do now is try to request a place on the agenda that far in advance.
Yeah, I think related to mid-November, I guess mid-November would be a good time.
Yeah, mid to late.
Unless I'm in Portugal, having moved there.
Right. Yeah. Sharpen up your passports, people. I know I have mine.
The only thing that I would suggest is that we just, if you want to get on the city council agenda, it would be good to run it through the mayor's office.
Okay.
Because this commission body does report directly to the mayor.
Okay.
So it might be good to have, obviously it's always good to have the mayor's voice on things, but it would be good for him to know that members of the commission would be there to give a report, and then he actually probably most likely be present.
Well, and also, we don't want to be presenting him with any curveballs that we present to them. So we'll have to make sure that whatever we do, he's seen first, and there's no surprises.
Phase two of Pulaski Park is about to begin, which I hope most of you know. So we're going to be doing a bunch of tree removals on the overlook, what they call the overlook, which is basically on the other side of the fence. Mm-hmm. So there's
a steep bank.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're gonna work there Saturday and Sunday in order to, we're probably gonna have to drop a lot of those trees whole because of their size and how steep the embankment is. We can't reach them in front of the look. So next week it'll look very different.
The purpose is just to remove trees that are not stable on the bank or
no, those trees do not are don't fit in with the construction plans.
What was it before the construction?
Yes, the overlooks, that's whole areas. I don't know if you've seen the plans, but you can view them online. That whole area is going to be filled in. So it's basically going to be a slope that's going to slope right out into the parking lot with multiple switchbacks.
Mm-hmm. Parking lot's going to be smaller?
Parking lot's going to be smaller, but they're in the process of studying, trying to figure out how to get the parking spaces back. I think like 25 to 30 parking spaces. So all those parking spaces that are now used by the roundhouse folks are going to be, the city owns the land, but they have a lease. The folks have a lease with the city to have X amount of parking spaces, so the city has to provide those spaces somewhere else.
Won't that increase chances of erosion, dropping that many trees?
I don't think so, because technically if we were to leave it alone and not do anything with it, yes. But because the whole thing is going to be completely blown up, we're just there taking the trees down because that's part of it's not covered under the contract. So the contractor's going to come in after us because the 28th is the kickoff meeting for the phase two. So after that, they'll be over here in the back of the park, will be all fenced off, and they'll be working on the construction, you know, filling in that, removing every concrete retaining wall, filling in, rubbing that whole hill and filling that void, and doing a bunch of landscaping. Construction work, so some new sidewalks, a lot of concrete work.
Is Mountain View doing that too?
No.
I don't want to get us too far off topic, yeah. Folks.
Okay, I'm
just conscious that
Mass West is the contractor. Mm-hmm.
One other quick question is the reconstruction to help it be more accessible?
I'm just going to ask that we say that thing for
accessibility.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's it.
Okay, all right. Thank you. Moving on us along, fall tree planting and watering. Rich, I'm going to ask you to, I'm happy to talk about watering, but, or chime into watering, but you're going to lead the discussion about the fall tree planting.
Well, after talking, you know, so obviously there's a whole bunch of factors this year because of the weather. And one of the things that I've been trying to figure out is whether or not actually it would be a wise idea to plant any trees this fall, given the fact that it hasn't really rained much. The other day we got 2.3 inches of rain, which was very beneficial. We have been watering the trees we planted last year and the year before, so we're over 200 trees. So if we were to plant, let's say 180 trees this fall, we have 380 trees that have to water, and that's, we're not capable of watering all of those trees at this time. The other issue is that in the beginning of October, DEP will actually sit down again and look at the drought level. So right now we are in a drought watch, which means we still have the ability to use potable water for water. We can still irrigate municipal parks and athletic fields. If we go to a drought warning, we won't be able to do anything except water what we can. No hose watering, no washing of vehicles, zip. Like what Worcester is experiencing at this moment, which is they can't even serve drinking water at the restaurants. Yeah, they stopped. Their reservoirs are below 50%. So
yeah, it's very severe there. I spoke to Ruth about it, and they're not able to meet the needs of their trees. They can only bucket water, and that may even be taken away from them, depending on if the drought continues. So it is a little bit of a harbinger for us.
It is, but I'm also feeling a little better because we got all this rain the other day, which increased the flow to Mill River, which is what our drought monitor is based on. But it's kind of out of our, because DEP is really responsible for actually setting the drought levels, you know, they're going to meet like in the first week of October again. So they'll put out another drought monitor list, and I think we're going to stay in a drought watch. I don't think we're going to go to a drought warning because of the rain. So after talking with Rob yesterday and actually trying to identify the bulk of the locations we have for fall planting, and correct me if I'm wrong, you said how many?
50 or
50 setbacks.
On lawns, basically setbacks.
So my thinking is that I think we should plant at least half of the trees that we have available to us in the nursery. So we have about 12 trees left in the holding area at the DPW yard that are fall and burlap trees that are earmarked for different places on Main Street and different, and also on Bridge Street. There were plantings that we did continue with this past spring because it got so dry we stopped. So if we can plant at least about 80 trees. Majority of the trees will be growback trees, so we're going to be relying upon the volunteers again, and we're hopefully going to probably do a little different. We're not going to do the Saturday day format, you know, the blast in the morning. Rob and I kind of figured that we can plant probably about 16 to 20 trees a week if we coordinate with volunteers and they do it after work. And the DPW really, so the other aspect is the support that I have to give, the DPW has to give to the volunteers, and really in essence by using the grow bags, it's not a lot compared to the fall and burlap.
I have a question about coordination.
Yes.
Of the possible heightening of the drought status.
Yep.
And the falling of the leaves. So I think you had thought of not planting until the leaves had come off. Maybe that's not true anymore.
No, I'm still thinking we should wait till the leaves drop. I mean, they're going to drop early this year.
Right.
As John indicated when we were over there in the nursery yesterday, which you can see already, they're going to drop quickly and fast.
So they might drop in late October or early October. And so the drought warnings come at a scheduled monthly?
They review them as needed, but the next drought monitor meeting is going to be the first week of October.
Right, so if there isn't a drought warning, then we might plant them, and then there's a possibility after we planted them that there would then be a drought.
I don't know. It depends on the weather.
Right.
I mean, that's kind of really. The thing is.
Sure.
Yeah. Well, so let me just.
But by then, they would be dormant.
Yes.
They would be dormant.
Yep.
Okay. So that was one of my questions. Is after leaf drop, is any of the water in there with water?
Yes.
Should.
Okay. So I'm going to just be a voice of concern here. They've been flat out, your crew has been flat out this summer trying to keep up with the watering demands of the trees we now have, and still we've lost a lot of trees. Those are visible signs of a struggling program to the residents out there. It's a sign that we're losing resources, that you know, no fault to us, but that, like, we've invested in resources and they have not panned out. So what I worry about is that we are putting more trees in the ground. We really don't have the capacity, barely, to manage the trees we currently have. Whereas if we keep them in a nursery, they are managing watering those trees. Even if we have to, like, pay them a little bit to keep our trees that we've already prepaid for alive, to me it just feels like a much better use of our time and resources when what's happening right now is probably the most important thing that is happening in the history of our tree program, which is a full-scale tree inventory, where that I think is going to require Rich's real diligent oversight. And I would just hate for Rich to be pulled away from that really, really important task. And also for more trees to go in the ground that we cannot manage. If we had a more sophisticated watering program, and I talked to Ruth a little bit about that, I talked to her about the possibility of applying for a DCR grant to put together a more elaborate watering program, I could see us putting more trees in the ground during a time of drought. But we don't have that, and we have this other just hugely important thing that we're faced with right now. And so I'm a voice of, this is not an opportune time to be planting. It's a time to be focusing on the tree inventory, a time to be figuring out what our watering plan is going to be going forward, because we don't have that squared away.
So the watering that you have now is a tank on the back of a truck?
We have three vehicles. We have two trucks that hold 250 to 300 gallons. We have one truck that holds 2,000 gallons.
And where does the water come? Where do you hold?
City water.
You fill it up, yep. Like at a, yes, hydrant or whatever.
Yep. So if we were to go to a drought warning, mm-hmm. I don't know if that was your next question, but I'll just elaborate. If we were to go to a drought warning, we would have to find a different water source. So there's two places. There's the Florence Field irrigation system, which we pump out of because it's on a well.
Okay.
So we can pump water out of there. The other place we could pump water out of is the middle Robertson Reservoir, and the channel that feeds from the lower to the middle. We did it years ago, mm-hmm. When we had a full street sweepers. They weren't allowed mm-hmm. to use potable water out of fire hydrants mm-hmm. to sweep anymore. Mm-hmm. So
you can't, like, use the Connecticut River, for example.
Accessing it would be too much of a pain. You can mm-hmm. We've used the Mill River, actually, after it goes over the dam underneath South Street before, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. When we did a bunch of hydro seeding, mm-hmm. but that creates a whole other set of problems, because then we don't have a tanker truck at the moment that actually operates. We have them, but it's a 1,000-gallon truck, and we'd have to go and pump the water out, and then we'd have to go disperse the water, and so that takes staff time. It's a CDL vehicle. So, for example, if we were set up to water and we had the volunteers watering for us, and mm-hmm. we went to the drought warning, they wouldn't be able to do anything with potable water. And that's kind of a concern of mine, although, again, it's a little alleviated because of the rain we got the other day. And I mean, fall is the best time to plant trees. I mean, it's kind of, we're kind of in a really tough spot, you know, and I really want to protect our investment of what we purchased already that's at Amherst, and I understand and respect what Lily is saying, but I also, I'm like on the fence because I think if it didn't rain the other day, I would say, you know what, forget it, we're not doing it. But now that it rained and the temperature's going to change, the temperature's going to drop, it's going to be in the 40s at night, 60s during the day. And I'm also looking for a little input from Jay because he's done this a lot longer than I have as well. You know, and the other thing is too, is I'm a little nervous about being saddled with planting 180 trees in the spring.
How would we scale back our planting, at least get a portion of them in the ground, given that it's going to be cooler and...
Well, that's, I think, once we move into the first or second week of October, I think we still have to, I think that's a possibility, but we have to look at, you know, what the environmental factors are. And I don't know, I mean, I'd like to hear what you have to say.
Well, you can't predict the drought.
No, that's for sure.
I've never seen one like this, but if it continues, keeps going, you can't predict. I think you've got to go ahead and, I think it's, we should plant during the fall this year. It is the best time. The trees are dormant. There's less quick reaction. You've got more time to deal with it than you do in the spring or summer. If the drought continues through the fall, we're going to lose a lot more than little trees. We're going to start losing big trees.
Especially with the help of Tree Northampton, you can focus more of your efforts on the inventory, Rich and the volunteers.
As far as inventory goes, I don't know what my time constraints are going to be. It's really going to be my time constraints, not going to be the crew. The crew's going to be doing their daily tasks. They won't be involved in the inventory unless the inventory, they come back to us and they, after they do a tree risk assessment, because as they go along, if they find trees that are extremely hazardous that we haven't identified, they're going to notify us and I've got to get them cut down. Mm-hmm. So that's the only way that the tree inventory would actually impact the crew. But the information gathering and the meetings, well, that's going to be on my plate.
So I have one other question.
Yeah.
There's 50 approximately 50 setback plantings, right?
Yep.
So I just want to clarify this. So if we do go to the next level of drought,
correct.
If we planted those people couldn't even water theirs except that they had like rain barrels or something, which are going to be dry
correct.
Anyway. Okay.
Correct.
We would have to
water.
So, right.
Somehow.
Right. So if was the plan, like let's say we do plant, is the plan to plant like that 80, approximately 80 trees that you were thinking that we might plant, would 50 of those be setback plantings?
No.
Okay, so if we don't go into the drought next level, hopefully, then we, the city, are not responsible for those watering those 50 trees?
Well,
that are we assuming the homeowner will do that?
We're not going to assume that they're going to do it because my experience this year was that we watered everything.
Okay.
Now you were watering setback?
Oh yeah, we watered everything. Everything that we
ever. That's crazy. I'm putting something in someone's jar.
Yeah, they got to agree to
that. I'm not comfortable with that at all. I didn't realize that. That feels like, I mean, we're already paying for a free tree to install it.
No, that doesn't mean that people weren't watering them. They weren't, but I had the employees check everything. Take a chance of losing it. So if a bag was full in a front yard, they just went by and went to the next one.
What happened this summer was that most people water the trees, but when the bags went on, it was very hard to tell if they were filling the bag. If they went on vacation for just 1 week and it skipped 1 week, the trees potentially were going to die. It was so hard to keep them alive. So I think the logic was anything we could do to keep them alive. It was very hard to know if someone went on vacation. I mean, one homeowner contacted me and said, you know, we want to go on vacation, what do we do? And actually I went and got a bag. It was actually in the tree belt. But they had been watering a tree in the tree belt for quite a long period of time.
And I put a tree, a bag on it, and it got watered, and I think, you know, who knows, it might have died if it was left for 2 weeks without water. It was hard to get the trees through. And even as it is, some of the ones that died, you know, did they not get the 20 gallons? Is that not enough? You know, it's hard to tell what happened to them. Not that many died, I don't think. I don't know what people reported.
No, actually, a lot of them, I mean, I think the ones that have full sun consistently are the ones that, like, the ones on King Street, they really struggled.
King Street.
But trees that had full sunlight, that, I mean, it was just so hot. Leaves scorch. I mean, it was just, and even if we put 20 gallons a week, you probably could put 100 gallons there. I don't think it would have mattered, but I think it was just the nature of the summer that we had. And I agree with Jay that I do feel this need to plant these trees, at least some of them, because my concern is too that when you plant a tree in the springtime, this is my own experience, and what I've read is that, you know, they are about to be leafed out, so all their energy actually goes to their top growth. So their root growth, so the tree is basically trying to balance itself out to get root growth and leaf growth at the same time. When we do this in the fall, I think you're gonna have trees that are actually gonna, you know, they're gonna try to sell some fibrous roots and start to get established. So they'll be partially established by the time the ground freezes and spring comes. So the other thing that John recommended when we were at the nursery is he said some of the trees that we felt that we took that were struggling, if we actually went in February, March, if we went and actually did some pruning and kind of cleaned their crowns out a little bit prior to that, it would actually reduce the shoot growth and actually help with early root growth in the springtime.
A year after planting?
No, this, after we plant them, after they go dormant, we plant them, and then come the springtime, we actually go and do some pruning of these trees before they leaf out.
So we had some of the opposite of that. Some of the maples had extensive amount, large amount of vegetation on them that we planted, the sugar maples, and that just made it harder for them probably to survive if we reduced them. That's what you're saying.
So I'm struggling here because we're running out of time to talk about this, and we've got a little ways to go. So I would like to make a suggestion that we extend this, but be very targeted and try to wrap it up and find some concluding remarks in the next 10 minutes, and then we push everything back by 10 minutes. Are you guys comfortable with that? But we need to show discipline and really stick to, like, what is our plan? So let me just summarize. I know you haven't spoken yet. I want to give you a chance to speak. But what I'm hearing so far is that I seem to be the only voice of caution when it comes to this being a very unique year for us in terms of the tree inventory. That coupled with the drought, I'm feeling like it's not the most opportune time to do a planting. But that's not what I'm hearing from the rest of you. I'd be happy to hear what Todd says, but then maybe we can think of, like, what is the most strategic thing? My concern is to demonstrate that we are using the city's resources most efficiently. We're not wasting city money by planting trees that we can't maintain.
I'd like to offer what I think is a compromise, because I partly agree with you that it needs to be done very carefully, but I also see a need to get some of these trees in the ground. We've talked about this, or I've talked about this before, but kind of a targeted single street hit where we really make a massive impact in one concentrated area and do an aggressive plant, street tree planting in either one or two streets or a certain neighborhood, whatever the case may be, that's identified by the tree warden. That allows them to kind of hit the neighborhood in a quick fashion rather than driving all over town to water the trees. They have one spot to go, water all the trees, you know, twice a week, whatever the case may be, but it can be done in a much more, you know, expedited manner. The private trees or the offset trees, you know, that's a whole different ball of wax, I think, that needs to be coordinated with the homeowner and get a commitment on their part. But from the city street tree point of view, I think concentrate on one or two streets in a concentrated area to let DPW hit them quickly. Mm-hmm.
Okay, Jay, you had your hand up?
I just think we've already bought the trees. If we wait till spring, it's going to be a big effort. And I think we need to take that into consideration, too. And if the trees have a better chance, I think, of surviving through the fall than they did this past summer.
is spring our only option? I mean, I'm just throwing this out there. Could we wait a whole year?
Contracts only approved for a year. So that means we'd have to...
Is there any such thing as extending the contract period? Given extenuating circumstances?
There is a possibility. It's a vendor cover sheet, so the contract really is run by the state, so we're piggybacking off the state's contract.
Okay, but back to Todd's suggestion, which is a departure from what I think you two may have discussed, which is concentrating on one or two streets for both the visibility impact and the efficiency of caring for them. Thoughts on that?
That's good for the city trees, but the setback trees, I think we need to get the commitment from the homeowner that they're going to take care of them.
It could be good to have a strip, a continuous strip, as Todd has suggested, but we actually have to have the right trees suitable for doing that. And we have a bunch of trees that definitely are not going in a tree belt. They're non-tree belt trees, so we have to deal with those separately. And then we have some that could be in tree belts. And if we identify a place with a long strip that we'd like to put them there, that, in a tree belt, that would be good. I think, though, that Rich and I wanted to do the setback trees first, which is 50 of the 80 anyway. So we're only talking about 30 trees that would be potentially a tree belt planting, which is the only opportunity for us to strip them. Next spring, we do have a bunch of trees that we could organize in that way. As a tree belt continues.
Okay, so still trying to bring this to fruition. It sounds like, I think we're moving to an agreement, I haven't heard from everyone, that setback trees need to be the responsibility of the owner. And even if the owners are going away for a week, then they find somebody to take care of the tree. You know, that's on them. Like, we just can't, that feels like it's spreading city resources too thin in my mind. And it's not acknowledging that we have, you know, invested in on a private property. That, you know, we're giving them a gift. So I would really love to see that get cleared.
I think that's true. And in the past, homeowners have watered their trees. But I think that the problem this summer was so difficult to get the water even onto the trees, so that just, in other words, if we hadn't put alligator bags on them, I don't think even if they were trying to water the trees, they would have kept up properly, because unless the berm is perfect around it and they're watching what they're doing, it just seemed too hazardous to let homeowners do it.
All right. But do we agree that's something we should be moving toward?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Well, I agree, because these folks have requested it, so they have the best idea.
Okay. So I'd like to see some type of, I don't know if you want to say contract, but, you know, if somebody signs,
we have.
Thank you for the tree, I agree to, boom, boom, boom.
We have a contract.
Okay.
I think the contract has generally been good, but this summer, keeping the trees alive became impossible.
Right, sure.
Really impossible.
Right. All right, so if it sounds like also you two coordinated to prioritize these 50 setback trees.
Well, we clarify that. We've talked about it, and in my own mind, to be honest with you, setback plantings, I think, are personally going to have a better success rate than in this environment versus street trees. Because setback plantings have a tendency to be much farther away from the roadway, they're farther away from the heat island. Yes, they are a pain to get to, in essence, sometimes if you're watering them. But for example, if we were to plant a whole row of trees along South Street, underwire trees, which we don't have enough underwire trees to do that, those are all exposed to complete sun. It's a huge heat island. And yes, we can water them more quickly, but their soil conditions are terrible. It's extremely dry. So, I mean, the setback plantings, I think, will be, I don't know, my own experience planting. Jay's got way more than I have. Rob probably has more than I do, but I just think it would be more successful. Then we would honor those people, the folks that actually ask for trees. And then the rest of the trees that we have, we could move towards what Todd was talking about, trying to plant them all in one location. For example, over on Bridge Street over here, we have four of those honey locusts, going in, so there's a place where there's just going to be four trees being bangled in their water. You know, but the way the list is now, and you've typed the list multiple times, it's definitely all over the place.
Well, this is the nature of not having treatment ready, and this is why I'd like for, you know, I'm relieved that we're getting to the point where we're not going to have this conversation every few months, because we'll have a document that will guide us. All right, so just to wrap it up, because we really are out of time. So you're proposing to plant 80 trees. Can we cap it at 80? And 50 of those will be setback trees. 30 of those we will try to...
What if I want to plant one more?
Well, in all that, but it's ambiguous which is 80. But
roughly, I think we should just agree to plant the trees that we have in the holding nursery.
Plus
the setback plantings for the time being. And then at that point, revisit where we're at, what the weather's like. But I think we should revisit this issue or have external discussions about this the beginning of October, after we figure out where our drought monitor is.
So one small issue there is that when doing setback plantings, I'm very conscious of trying to group trees. So I try and get neighbors and to get little groups of trees. And often it'll be a tree, a setback tree, and then a tree in the tree belt. So I would hope that we would plant every time there's a cluster, we would plant the whole cluster, if we can.
Okay,
so that includes some tree belt trees.
Okay. And then the last thing I would just ask, which is, you know, we're new with this monitoring and overseeing a tree inventory, so I don't know if they've given you a sense of how much you need to be on call for it, to do a really crackerjack job of, like, doing quality control to see that they're doing good work. You know, I mean, to me it sounds completely insane, given that we use 50 volunteers in a day to inventory maybe 450 trees. The idea of doing like 13,000, which is what we're talking about, 11,000 trees and 2,000 sites in 6 weeks, I can't wrap my brain around this one. So, you know, we want to make sure that they're not moving so fast to meet a deadline that they're doing crap work and that we're going to be left with, you know, and not a product that we want. So I guess maybe check in with Alan Snow to see what kind of oversight he thinks is required. I just don't want you to be squeezed and then find you don't have time to do the most important task that we probably will do in the next 10 years, which is inventory.
We don't care until it's, it needs to be done by February from our perspective. So I mean, I don't think there's a huge, especially the maintenance plan. I mean, they can take all spring for that. So it's not we're no giant.
I don't feel like
that raises the issue. Is do they have to do it in November one more time?
Well, that's what the contract says, right?
No,
it doesn't.
No.
Okay, so we're not here.
The DCR contract got signed, and it's good for.
That's good for a year, but I thought the contract, the PD...
No, it's a single deliverable, so when they're done, they're done.
Okay, that gives me a lot.
So they said we'll be done in November.
That was the time, and I have not really had a chance to talk to Andy, but I just got the schedule for the other day.
So is it possible to ask them to be later, to come a little later?
I don't think, no, I would prefer they don't come later. I prefer they do it now.
Not so much that, I just would love to know how much... you know, oversight you're going to need, and I don't know if you know that, except for talking to another city who's used a service and can speak to what they require. All right, so I think we're pretty much there. Okay. Thank you. The tree inventory.
I don't have.
This is perfect because now we won't be late if you have nothing to say about it.
I think we've pretty much, I don't have any news other than once the contracts are signed, I'll get a contract number signed and I'll sign this agreement with David and we'll be on our way. And then we'll set a date for our kickoff meeting. And then I will inform everyone when that's going to be.
Okay, great.
So, and then in the meantime, I'll do a little homework about time commitments and what's going to be expected of. I mean, really, all they really asked for in here was client's responsibilities, provide Davy Tree Group with all maps and other information necessary at no charge. This includes but not limited to digital ortho photographs available GIS data layers, electronic or paper copies of maps for roads, pavement widths, right-of-way widths, boundaries, utilities, and electronic file or printed list of street names and endpoints. The client is requested to coordinate with Davey Tree Resource Group project staff to host and conduct an informational kickoff meeting immediately prior to the start of the field work. Provide daily contact information and directions as needed during the inventory process, which would be probably my deal. I don't think it'll be, because Andy will have given them all the information. Client is requested to complete an urban forest management questionnaire, provide electronic or printed copy of the current shade tree ordinance, landscape regulations, and other urban forestry program information as needed. So that's it. We don't have a really kind of street tree ordinance, that's a tree ordinance, but. So there will be some legwork, I think, on my part, but I mean, this is one of the reasons why I decided to do this professionally.
Absolutely.
Instead of a volunteer, because that would have been a totally different ball of wax, so. And they've done this. How long they been in business, Jay?
Well, they helped actually write up their proposals for I3. Yeah. Pretty good.
Yeah. I mean, I think we got very lucky considering that the low bidder was $30,000 cheaper, but was an incomplete bid and had a lot of holes in their proposal. So they didn't really seem like they actually wanted the job, I guess I would say. And I don't know why, but it is what it is. I think we got very lucky. So I think we're going to have a really good product.
And Jay, you volunteered to help. I heard you
can help out with Rich, okay. Keeping track of it.
Right.
Thank you.
Good.
We supervise them at Worcester.
Oh.
They're a heavy hitter in the industry. I mean, they're Davey Tree.
Yeah. They'll pull in the resources they need to get it done quickly. It's not like.
And are they working with a more efficient software than iTree?
Yeah, they developed their own software.
It just feels like we are just plodding through, like scrolling to find the right species.
Yeah.
This is very slow. Yeah, I mean, for us, each tree took like at least five minutes.
Yeah.
I think one of the things, though, that is going to be interesting, because we've asked for a tree risk assessment, for every tree, a level 2 tree risk assessment, depending upon the time frame that they recommend, so every tree will receive a time frame, you know, for reinspection. It's the second name put on the form. So typically you never go over a year. So at the year mark, somehow or another, we as a municipality are gonna have to go back and do another tree risk assessment. Because now that we're gonna have this document, and Terry can attest to this because we do get a lot of tree claims, we have a document and city's insurance company asked for to provide all pertinent documentation in regards to the last time the tree was inspected. And we have a tree risk assessment that was done 2 years ago, and there were identified risks with it, and we didn't mitigate those risks. That's going to be a problem. So
if you're showing that you're mitigating the biggest risks,
that's correct.
In order,
that's correct.
You're fine.
Yeah, so whatever the largest defect is, that is considered that's how the risk of the tree is going to be evaluated. So if, you know, there's a hole at the base of the tree, that's the biggest risk of all, so versus whether there's stuff in the canopy or not.
So the trees that they write up is having a risk.
Yes.
Once they put that down as risk, then every year you have to.
Depending upon what the time frame, and some of those trees will most likely be less than that. It'll be 6 months.
Oh, really?
Yes.
So it's you personally, really, then?
Myself or Tony, or unless we decide to actually continue to do this somehow with a professional company and actually encumber monies every year to do this, that's a whole other conversation. I guess we got to see what we have for a timeline first. But that's stuff I've just been kind of thinking about. Because I think the city of Springfield is due for another public shade tree inventory, and they did theirs 10 years ago. And so, you know, 10 years is out of date. So because of the, you know, tree loss and things of that, and tree plantings and changing hardscape conditions and so on and so forth. So,
but if you're keeping that inventory going, you know, trees removed, trees planted, keeping up with that inventory.
That's why I think it's important to find out if Tree Keeper is going to be the appropriate software platform for us, or if the municipality will duplicate the same thing, then we'll be golden. Have to purchase a license to run it, so we'll water. So I don't know, it's going to be interesting.
Yeah, well, I have to enter a service request for every tree that they feel deemed necessary?
No, you mean the...
The risk ones?
No. No, because what they're going to do is they're going to utilize the existing, they're going to utilize the existing MGL Chapter 87 laws and how to determine what a city tree is based upon the information that we give them, which is right-of-way layouts, GIS mapping, which is based on the assessor's map, which is not correct. So basically, I think we're going to end up, actually, they're going to be basically pulling about 20 feet off the curb everywhere, you know?
So then it would just be a work order? So you have a trail of...
You have a trail, so you're going to know what trees are city trees and what trees are not city trees.
Right, so if you have to go out and cut a tree because it's a risk, I'm going to have to do a work order for all those trees that they deem necessary, right?
Probably.
You see an intern in your future?
No, she's already, like, I can see her papers over her head. The present work order system we have is, she can explain to you, I get the work orders, I don't have the time to even create a work order. I asked Terry to do them because it's, how long does it take to make a work order from beginning to end? Service request to the actual closing of it.
Well, because it's so slow, probably 45 minutes of work order.
Oh my gosh.
This is why I don't overrides.
The computer's slow, like when you type?
Well, no, it's the system and what it's asking.
What it asks.
But I also think, I think where I am in the building might be the computer's a tad slow. I have no idea. But they're hoping that once Rich gets his new laptops and I take that one over, that it might be better for me. I have no idea, but...
The other thing too that will make it easier is that once we have done the inventory, basically engineering will be taken out of the picture in a sense because we won't have to do a service request anymore. So right now every tree that we actually have to look at, we have to do a service request to the engineering division because they are the ones that hold the records for the right of way. They will go out and if they can't determine it by using a pre-existing spreadsheet or manuals that we have, books, then they will actually go out and do actually measuring based on the right-of-way card that they have. Because every city street has a different, they're all different.
That's why I had to pay to cut down my giant maple.
So that'll be beneficial. So this is, again, this having doing this is going to do a bunch of different things. I think it's going to move us along. And hopefully we will be not as cumbersome as we are now.
Okay. Thank you.
One last question. You said 20 feet from the curb for risk assessment?
Possibly. It depends. Okay. It depends. Like I said, the GIS layer is not accurate.
Right.
So they're going to use a combination of tools to get there.
All
right.
Thank you. Todd, walk, bike, draft.
Bike. Yeah, sure. So the consultant has presented a draft walk bike report, and I had some. I reviewed it as much as I could. It's really thick, but I had some macro comments, and I had some micro comments. The macro comments was that the document lacked any kind of principles or value statement or overall goal statement. It got really specific really fast, and I thought it missed the nature of the public meetings and a lot of the message that was delivered to the consultant through the public meetings. And so I requested that, you know, that part be kind of taken out and looked at. And Wayne supported that. He said it was also one of his comments, and that should be the first chapter, and that chapter should in fact be the one that's incorporated into the city's master plan. It should be noted that both this document and the city's master plan are toothless documents under state law, so they really don't mean a hill of beans when it comes down to it, but it would be nice to at least get some things on paper regarding kind of the values of the city. This contract was a regional contract, so it was also work for Belchertown, and it was also kind of supposedly for the whole county. I imagine what they heard in the Northampton meeting was possibly different from what they heard in the Belchertown meeting, and wanted that reflected in the goals and values.
Can I just back up for a second and ask a question? So you went to the meeting yesterday and you reported what you're now telling us. Okay, and then one of the things I want to ask is, did you ask them whether our committee would have an opportunity to weigh in and provide feedback, or has that, have we missed that opportunity?
Well, we can definitely, I mean, that draft document is going to be sent back to the consultant. The consultant did not attend the meeting yesterday morning, but we have maybe a couple more days to throw some comments their way before they wrap this thing up. The other thing that I wanted to see was there was a huge table of possible projects. It's kind of thrown out there from what they heard in the public and everything else, and it didn't seem to be sorted in any particular way. I suggested that they have a map of a very specific area or street with, you know, kind of a prioritized list of projects that were identified just for that area, as opposed to kind of a gigantic
and
list.
And is this, do you mean prioritized just based on public feedback at meetings? Because it's such
or
a...
Or based on the, you know, consultant's best judgment, or, you know, through conversations with city departments or whatever, or looking at other transportation plans that the city has. One concern of mine was there was a page that was for shade trees. It was one page, but I didn't see a lot of integration of shade trees into the design specifics. So they basically went through various elements of pedestrian design, whether it be a completely shared street, which means there's no sidewalk, you all kind of mingle and share the street, you know, versus then an on-street pedestrian path versus then a sidewalk versus, you know, the myriad of options. And this led to some further revelations that I think, you know, get to Rob's question earlier. So I wanted to see, you know, if you are going to have, a sidewalk on one or both sides, I wanted some acknowledgement that, you know, there needed to be an adequate tree belt to separate the drivers from the pedestrians and provide shade, et cetera, et cetera. That wasn't in there. And it started a discussion with the planning department about, and the DPW was present, about kind of how the city does sidewalks. And what was kind of revealed through this discussion was that over the last couple of years, the city has made it a policy where sidewalks are a given. So every new project, sidewalks are kind of automatically put into the project, and that requires zero public input. You only get public input if you deviate from the given, which is that sidewalks are going to be installed. So if for some reason DPW decides not to install a sidewalk, that's when it triggers an open meeting with the Transportation Committee of the City Council. And the policy is basically that the city seemingly has taken its subdivision design rules and regulations, which are meant for new development, and applied them to retro development of existing city streets, which I think creates a really suburban type of street network, where you have a 24-foot wide paved street with a 2-foot green belt and then a, you know, 3.5-foot sidewalk on both sides of the street, almost regardless of land use density. And so my conversation with Wayne was that seemed flawed, and that we needed to go through a more complicated process of talking about, you know, some context-based design solutions, and that, well, sidewalks aren't necessarily needed everywhere. And, you know, before we put in a street light, we do a study to see if the intersection needs a street light, and maybe the same thing should be required with sidewalks. You know, we ran into that, you know, it's just not the way it's done, which is fine. But I think there's an opportunity for the tree warden, I think there's an opportunity for the tree warden to be more involved in the early stage engineering design of DPW started projects. And I think that I certainly have a concern that if the default is that a sidewalk can go anywhere, then that is automatically precluding, possibly, new street tree plantings within the right of way. in the future as more and more of the sides of streets gets paved over with concrete. And so I don't want to make this a sidewalk versus shade tree discussion, but I do think we need to start taking steps to include shade trees in the design and engineering discussion with DPW prior to, you know, construction starting on the project.
Do you have some thoughts on that?
Yes, I do, because I started talking about that, reminding me of Hinckley Street. So Hinckley Street is going to be completely renovated from curb to curb, and it's going to be adding new sidewalk on, I believe, on one side of the street. Maybe it's both.
Where's Hinckley?
Hinckley Street is in
Bay State.
Bay State. So
One
of the issues, obviously one of the issues on Hinckley Street is a lot of mature shade trees. Like, we did have a book of shade tree for multiple trees that are going to be removed to accommodate the sidewalk, because on a part of Hinckley Street there is no sidewalk. But the department has adopted the complete streets model, where every time, and Todd is correct, every time a street is renovated, they try to squeeze out as much sidewalk either on one side or both sides as possible, which, for example, North Street, which totally decimated the ability to have any kind of street tree plantings. So the last few, I was not involved with the North Street project at all. There was my, because it was done before I was the tree warden. But on Hinckley Street, I became involved because of the street trees and because of the preservation of the street trees that are there. And then Felix Harvey was the actual design engineer who used to be on the former public shade tree committee. So, you know, he and I spent a lot of time going over that plan and trying to figure out how to preserve the existing trees and where to plant new trees. But it is, it would be something that is good. I mean, you know, this is why we're fortunate here in Massachusetts, obviously, that we can do the setback planning program, because that really makes a huge difference. But it also, but even though it's a setback planning program, what eventually that tree is a private tree.
Right, and they can get rid of it if they want to.
And they can get rid of it. So two years later, someone else could sell their house, right, and they could say, oh, we don't want that tree there. The agreement's over, and it's gone.
Right.
So I think it would be extremely important, because we do have a tendency to tape over a lot of things, I would have to say.
And or to integrate, you know, the structural soil to be able, you can still pave.
Yes.
You know, you can,
right,
you can,
there
you know,
are,
you
there
can
are,
have a patio and have a tree growing up.
Yeah, but it's also just, remember, you know, there are whole sorts of ADA restrictions about the width of the sidewalk, so you can't, even if you had a mostly concrete area, you couldn't necessarily put a tree in if it, like, narrows
right,
the tree, the sidewalk to a degree where a tree,
right,
tree interferes.
Right.
So it is truly tricky.
It is tricky, but it is successful, because you can actually go to the eastern part of the state, and Cambridge is a good example. Dave Leftport,
yeah,
I mean, they use flexi pave everywhere. So all the new sidewalk plantings they've done, that they've had structural soil and flexi pave over the top of them, which is a permeable, looks like permeable stone. You touch it, it's almost got like a rubbery feel to it. And it's permeable, but it actually supports, it supports wheelchairs, bicycles. So it's in lieu of actually having a tree grate, or because he stopped using tree grates. So there are options out there. I think it's just a matter of incorporating those options and then being open to using new techniques that come along in future years to plant trees in the public right of way where there's conflicts between curbing, you know, conflicts in the streetscape, basically.
So, Todd, do you feel like there's anything we as a committee should voice to as part of this whole process?
Possibly not, you know, for this planned process, but I think, you know, we have uncovered maybe the sole source of the conflict between public shade trees and pedestrian connectivity and sidewalks. And I think that we need to convene something to discuss more creative design solutions and even process solutions to have the two things be in less conflict. Is this going to get worse?
Do you feel like you had buy-in from Wayne?
Up until that, you know, he agreed with my comments on the plan, but up until the process point.
How come?
Then, because he left the room and, you know, pushed back pretty hard, but, you know, cities move, change slowly.
Yeah, and how about the other people in the room? This, how many people were there?
There was a representative from DPW, and there were two other committee members. Not a whole lot of discussion. There was a representative from PVPC who seemed to share some of my thoughts. Ish.
Any other questions, thoughts? Is there something that you could summarize in a draft so that, you know, we could actually officially submit it?
Yeah, I mean, I probably don't know all the terminology of whatever the city has officially adopted, you know, whether, you know, where that policy is, and maybe I can just sit down with Rich briefly and kind of get a sense.
And the policy that sidewalks are always a given?
Yeah.
Can you think of situations where you would prefer not to see a sidewalk? Like, I'm trying to think of, like, where I would rather trade out sidewalks and in.
Well, you don't need them on both sides of the street, most places. That's the part that I really object
to. Yeah, as long as you provide appropriate pedestrian crossings for people, not mid-block crossings, but crossings at intersections, people can always get to the other side. You know.
So was it really the bike ped that really pushed? Because I think they had a big, in James, I'm thinking in particular James Zonthal, a big influence on the North Street design, which really pushed to get sidewalks on both sides of the street.
This is ASHTO based, Mass DOT, complete streets push, right? This is traffic engineers driving the design of our urban infrastructure. And that starts, you know, through the ASHTO guidelines, and Mass DOT's complete streets is a Stripes on Streets version of ASHTO normal.
And ASHTO stands for?
It's the National Transportation, you know, guidelines that all engineers use for street design, is where we get the widths and the turning lane radiuses for fire trucks and everything.
Right, right, okay.
And they haven't, you know, and those slowly change, but for the most part, they're very conventional, very traditional 1960s type of.
So that's why down at the Rotary on Conn Street, there's a sidewalk next to the bowling alley that goes to nowhere.
Yeah. Just like the sidewalk that goes to nowhere.
What a waste of money.
By Woodard and
Horrendous.
Although they did finally connect that, though.
But, Todd, can you just alter the guidelines, talk about streets with no sidewalks?
Yeah, they do. I mean, they list them as an option for low vehicle.
So has that not been adopted by the city? Is that what you're saying?
Well, that document is toothless, so it's not really going to mean much from a actual boots on the ground, get it done perspective. What's going to rule is that the city has adopted Mass DOT's Complete Streets program, which says when you're redoing a street, sidewalks on both sides, unless.
So could we not say that we are very much in support of the ALTA guidelines and we hope that they would consider them? Seems they just paid for them, the city.
Well, the ALTA guidelines don't say which model is preferred. They simply lay out what each obvious model of pedestrian transportation is. You either walk on the street, you walk on the street with a stripe, you walk on the sidewalk, you walk on both sides of the sidewalk, you walk on the sidewalk next to a bike lane. I mean, they just lay out the, you know, what exists.
I have one more question. How does this draft plan, does it integrate at all with the planning that was done on Main Street? They had some public forums, they had some demonstration sites.
So yes and no. So Wayne also said that they are going to attempt to piggyback a redesign of Main Street on an existing tip number for some intersection design. They're going to add a redesigned Main Street to kind of to get in the queue. He stated that they are going to start going forward with some sort of design process for the redo of Main Street, and they're going to take the preferred design alternative that's in the plan and use that as kind of a baseline. That's not where we're going to end up necessarily, but that's what they're going to use for budgeting for now to get it on the tip.
I see. And what was the preferred design?
It's
in there.
It should be in there, yeah.
Okay. All right. Huh. All right. Okay, anything, so in terms of trying to get a tangible outcome out of this, will you summarize your recommendations, send it to us, and we can determine, or we can vote to submit it as a, you know, an official recommendation from the tree commission?
So I think the ship's probably sailed for the report. I mean, if you have specific stuff based on your review of the report, maybe send it directly to Wayne. I'm going to be doing the same on a little bit more detailed basis. But I think the main game is going to be to open up a discussion around getting a little bit more creative with addressing pedestrian connectivity from a comprehensive design point of view, and not just blankly throwing sidewalks on both sides of the street with a complete ignoring of the tree belt.
I'm actually kind of surprised that we have so little time to react to this. I mean, we just got this 4 days ago.
Sure, yeah.
But as you said, it's a toothless document. I just, you know, even toothless documents, sometimes Wayne can present a little bit like it's, like this is the guiding document, and this is, there was a public process that went into it, and that's that. So I just want to make sure that.
Yeah, there was an acknowledgement of the public shade tree lobbying to get shade trees kind of in the document. And I'm not sure if the one page that's in the document is
it.
But I don't think that the designs that I saw and the wording of the critical features of some of the designs, to me, didn't quite capture what was heard at the public forums.
Okay. All right.
Thanks for going
down. Yeah,
thank
you. All right, so if anyone does have additional comments about the plan, it sounds like you send them directly to Wayne.
Yeah.
Sorry about that, everybody. Okay. Thank you. Other business not reasonably anticipated? Yes.
A couple questions, actually.
Yeah.
Number one, I see that the city is going through a crowdfunding exercise for a parklet on the alley. Wondering if crowdfunding is now an option for other types of city projects, including, oh, I don't know, shade trees.
Don't know the answer to that question.
Do you mean purchasing shade trees? Or
no,
what?
It's crowdfunding. It's open, you know, people can just go online and throw some cash at the parklet. That's
yeah.
What.
Yeah, I saw, no, I definitely saw that, and I found it was interesting that there was so much attention thrown to, like, a $10,000 project. It struck me as a little bit like, just over promotion of a really, really teeny thing. I think that they'll probably raise far more than $10,000. $10,000 is just like nothing to raise.
Well, it's a mass development project grant, whatever, so they're going to throw in 10. The city has to raise 10, and supposedly, I guess they have to raise it through crowd.
They have to raise it through crowd?
I don't know if they have, but I think that. There was something like that.
Okay.
But to me, it opens a huge door mm-hmm. for crowdsourcing for all kinds of city projects, which I wasn't aware cities could ask for money in that way. So I'm very curious if we could add some shade
cities
tree projects.
Cities can ask for, I mean, the city has done it before, they just haven't done it in this format. Like, you know, when we tried to buy conservation and like before CPA was passed, Wayne's office used to all the time solicit donations from individuals to buy conservation land. So I don't think this is anything new. It's just the format of doing it through a social media that is different.
Well, I'd suggest that we actively and aggressively pursue crowdsourcing for public shade trees.
If we have something in mind, like a particular project. Like I wouldn't want to do it for general. I think it's helpful to galvanize around a very specific thing. But you know, you bring up a point that I'd like to make, which is I invited our conservation planner, Sarah LaValle, who I think is really an important player and needs to come to one. I think she's a high priority person to come to one of our meetings. Rich and I were talking about this. And she's accepted the invitation. She's coming in, I think in early October. And she is also our CPA planner, and so I asked her to provide us with some information about what sort of grant requests we could make regarding shade trees for CPA funding. Because we know it can be done, but I'd like to know like the full gamut of the kinds of projects we could ask for funding for. That is a huge pot of money. We don't even need to do crowdsourcing. It's a pot of money that's just waiting there to be taken, drawn from. And there's not a whole lot of community competition for it at the moment. So I think that we should definitely consider that. But I would always like to urge us to not just like ask for money just in a kind of a general way, but if we have something we can galvanize each other.
So really just, so CPA grants is a rolling, or is it annual?
Yeah,
I
think it's twice a year.
2 rounds a year.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Next one, please.
So she is going to come to the meeting, and hopefully before the meeting have some information to provide us, and we can also ask for more about that during the meeting. But do you want to follow up very specifically with that? Like, ask the mayor's office about this whole model of crowdsourcing and whether it's open for other projects? Do you want to do that?
Or you if you wish.
Okay, that would be true. Do you have anything else?
I do. We had talked about the last meeting, it was in the minutes, some sort of public shade tree design or planting guidelines. Yeah. We had talked about other kind of exploring ways to paying for that. And I was wondering, Rich, if we could explore possibly district local technical assistance funds with Pioneer Valley Planning Commission as a sustainability project. They're always looking for ways to get, I mean, that's money that the state sets aside, gives to a planning commission. It's up to the planning commission to reach out to the towns and spend it. I don't know if they have. It's the start of the fiscal year, so good time to go and ask for some money.
What is the body again, Tom?
Well, it'd be the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission is given what's called DLTA funds from the state every year, district local technical assistance money. And it's up to the planning commission to reach out to the towns to expend the funds, and they usually don't. So it'd be good to kind of just jump on that. And I think we could grab a planner to, you know, be a body to help us create those guidelines for public shade trees.
What's the body again?
PVPC, Pioneer Valley Planning Commission.
So you're talking about possibly using the funds to actually set guidelines for planting public shade tree, or guidelines for all aspects of public shade tree?
Yeah, for like, you know, what goes where, what species are appropriate, how they get planted.
Like the two models we were looking at
exactly.
at that meeting. Yeah. Right, the Vermont one.
You know, and you could tie it to climate change or whatever you got to do to make it fall into their category, which is given to them by the state.
And Rich would have to be the one to apply.
The city has to ask PVPC.
I see.
Are we doing something with Vermont guidelines?
No, we were using it like as a model to create our own.
I know, but is that in process in some way, or is someone doing that?
No, that's what I'm suggesting, that we
have someone do. Okay.
Yeah, I have to go back and look at my notes, but I actually asked Molly about that.
Yeah, because we're looking at the grant possibility.
Yeah, right. I'd have to go back and look at my notes. I'm forgetting what she told me.
This is a nice little document.
So Todd, are you thinking that maybe in some way to modify that with his words about different environment, or what would you be your goal to actually send that to modify?
Yeah, I mean using it as a base and making it.
Yeah, I mean this is the one Molly said that this is the one that regionally most municipalities use. And she's not heard of municipalities adapting this? Because this generally tends to be pretty generically good for this whole region. So what is your thought? Like, why can't we just use this?
Maybe we could. I haven't gone through it with a fine tooth comb.
Okay, Jay, you have, haven't you?
I like that. I also like Cornell's.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I guess we need to come to a decision point. Like, are we going to use Cornell's, use Vermont's, use a blend of the two, or create our own? From what I heard, from speaking to Molly, it sounded like using our own seemed a little bit like reinventing the wheel, just because professionals have put a lot of work into these. But, you know, I can't speak to that at all because I haven't studied them and really don't really know what to do.
I would agree with that assessment.
You can get this online?
Yeah.
Yeah, you can get it online. Yeah, you just follow, Google this down here.
All right, well, we'll take a look at it.
Okay. And then we can just say we follow this guideline, and whenever, you know, whoever is interfacing with public trees needs guidelines, they have to follow this. And maybe we could, I don't know. Now, do you see that as needing to get into actual ordinances in the city, like that everyone, any developer or something needs to follow these guidelines? Is that something that usually gets inserted into an ordinance? Or?
Yeah, I would say, I mean, especially since the city seems to be using the subdivision rules and regs as the governing body for all design decisions in regards to trees and sidewalks.
Okay.
All
right. So before we absolutely go with this, Jay, do you want to just look at it a little more closely? Because, I mean, if we're going to kind of put our weight behind this and say this is what we're, you know, affirmatively gonna follow, we at least need one of us among here to read the whole thing. And maybe you two, Jen?
Yeah, I would read it too.
Okay.
I'll just download it tomorrow.
You know what? You can have this copy.
Unless do
I can get another copy. Sounds like Rich has a couple of them.
Because it's easy. You have this? Because it's not that hard for me to download it.
I'll
get somebody to print it.
So, and can we just create a deadline around that? How much time do you guys think you need?
Just give me a goal. I just have to have a quick clarification. So the goal would be that this document, let's say there's a developer to hand out, is it every single bit, you know, that involves planting, you know?
Well, it contains, a comprehensive tree list of every possible public shade tree that can be planted in the city. And it has kind of where they go.
Okay.
You know, where it's appropriate for them to go.
Mm-hmm. And do you also want, I haven't looked at the document, but do you also want it to also have like specs of how they're supposed to be planted? You know, like.
There's a lot of those out there too.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, do you want that in the document too?
That should be in the document.
That's what I'm thinking.
Some agreed upon spec.
That's not from 1970 that people download from their computer. Oh, yes, it does. Because, you know, the workers are going to do what's on the spec.
If you want.
Okay. Yeah, right.
Okay, so just so we can wrap this up, how much time do you guys think you need to review this and determine whether or not we can actually adopt this as our own?
Our next meeting, by the way, is October 5th.
I think I've gone through this before, and I think I've eliminated a few trees that are on their list.
I need longer than October 5th.
Okay.
So I could do whatever the next one. Yeah, what is that? What's that?
2 weeks later, the 19th.
October. I could do it by the 19th.
Okay. Good. Thank you.
What's that?
Anything else on your other business, Todd?
I didn't know if we got a sense of where Prospect Street ended up in a design and all of our comments.
Prospect. Pleasant Street? We are supposed to have a meeting. I'm waiting for the information coming from Wayne. supposed to happen sometime this month, but it's already kind of gone by, so it's going to happen next month. So I don't.
I guess at what, pre-construction or?
No, actually, a meeting about all the comments that were given by DPW and by Shade Commission. So that would be at some point, because they're ready to move on that now because this, the land swap apparently has happened. So basically, we're now on from Hoyle Street to Ogden Road. Extend our feet a little bit.
You mean it was state?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Okey dokey. That is it for me. Marilyn, would you like to do a wrap up?
Okay, here's what I got. Rich, finalize the letter to the mayor by October 1st.
Or not finalize the letter, just clarify.
Have to get back to the mayor's staff. What we're actually looking to have the meeting. What level of input do we need for the meeting from the mayor's perspective?
Okay, sorry, just that.
The letter's fine.
Have the tree inventory contract signed, Rich. Schedule kickoff meeting for the tree inventory. Draft the press release around the time of the kickoff meeting. And prepare for the planting of about half the trees in the nursery, which is about 80, 50 setback and 30 tree belts, with a plan to do 16 to 20 per week, unless drought conditions worsen and we'll leave you at that time. Lily, contact mayor's office to get on city council agenda after election regarding a annual report of our commission. Todd, inquire about the crowdsourcing and look at, Marilyn, draft the 1 or 2 pager annual report and share that with Lily. Rob, continue working with Rich and volunteers regarding the fall tree planting. Jay and Jen, review the Vermont and Cornell tree selection plan to determine whether or not to adopt it, or as Todd suggested, involve PVPC. And also Jay, assist Rich with the tree inventory. And all of us, send any questions about the walk, bike, Northampton recommendations directly to Lee.
Thank you.
Yep.
That was very thorough. Motion to adjourn.
Adjourn.
Second.
Adjourn.
All in favor?
Aye.
Meeting adjourned.